Hello there, welcome to Africa News, bringing you the top stories on the continent. Taking power in line with constitutional measures, Burkina Faso's army chief takes the reins of the country following the resignation of President Blaise Compaoré. In Nigeria, a triple bombing at a bus station in Gombe state kills at least 8 people and wounds dozens. The explosions are once again raising fears amongst Nigerian commuters. And remembering the past, here in the French capital, a memorial paying homage to victims of Rwanda's 1994 genocide is inaugurated. But first to our top story. Burkina Faso's army chief, Nivere Honore Traoré, has taken over the reins of the country, pledging a swift return to normal constitutional life. The move comes following the resignation of President Blaise Compaoré, who stepped down after violent protests against plans to extend his 27-year rule. Earlier, Compaoré confirmed the presidency was now vacant and called for elections within 3 months.
Je reste disponible à ouvrir avec vous.
I will remain available to open negotiations for a period of transition, at the end of which I will cede power to a democratically elected president. I have decided to withdraw the contested bill and move forward with its scrapping. The government is dissolved, and from this day, the 30th of October, I declare the state of martial law all over our national territory to be finished.
There is a commitment to proceed without delay, to consult with all the forces and components of the nation, to lead to a return to normal constitutional life. We call on all citizens in the different spheres of national life to respond to what is asked of them.
As you've been hearing there, it's been an historic day in Burkina Faso, where the reign of one of Africa's longest-serving rulers has apparently ended. For demonstrators, the impossible has become the reality. Luke Trago brings us the story.
They called for President Blaise Compaoré's head, and just a day after protests degenerated into fierce rioting, hundreds of thousands in the streets of Burkinabe capital Ouagadougou got their wish.
In order to preserve democratic gains as well as social peace, I declare a vacancy of power with a view to allowing a transition that should finish with free and transparent elections in a maximum period of 90 days.
Compaoré had been attempting to change the constitution, prolonging his 27 years in power. Protests that began on Tuesday boiled over 2 days later as thousands stormed the parliament, setting fire to the building and demanding Compaoré step down. In the wake of his resignation on Friday, the head of Burkina Faso's armed forces stepped in.
Given the power vacuum, considering the urgency of saving the nation, and following the statement of October 30th, 2014, I have decided that I will assume from this day the responsibilities of the head of state.
That may not prove so popular with ordinary Burkinabes, however. They'd wanted retired general and popular defense minister Kwame Luge to take over.
Staying with this story, Joe Penny is in Ouagadougou. We can cross live to him now. Joe, thanks for being with us this evening. Take us through, if you will, the atmosphere following such an eventful day in Burkina Faso.
Yeah, well, it started in the morning when you could say hundreds of thousands of protesters gathered in the Place de la Nation, which was formerly Place de la Revolution. And then they went to the army headquarters and demanded that Blaise Compaoré step down. Now, when the chief of defense staff, Honore Traoré, made his press conference saying that he would take power and that Blaise Compaoré was no longer president, people were in a very celebratory mood, running through the streets and shouting with joy and singing and dancing, not because Honore Traoré was taking power, but because they felt that they had won against Blaise Compaoré, and they had kicked him out of power after 27 years. But now we are hearing that another army officer, the Lieutenant Colonel Yakuba Zida, made a competing statement that he is president as well, This is apparently said at the Place de la Nation in front of protesters later on in the afternoon. So there are two camps currently, both claiming that they're in charge of the country. And so the situation is a bit confusing at the moment.
So, Joe, amid this confusion, then, how big a task is forming a transitional government likely to be for Traoré?
I think that's what's definitely being under the... Well, the first thing he needs to... First thing before any transition is negotiated, there needs to be a clear answer to who is actually in charge of the transition.
Okay,
so
Joe.
So until that question is answered... the transition is sort of a second step.
Okay, Joe Penny reporting for us from Ouagadougou. Thanks very much for keeping us up to date this evening. Well, Blaise Compaoré was a key ally for France and the US in West Africa. The former president mediated in numerous conflicts in Ivory Coast, Togo, Mali, Guinea, and he supported America's war against Al-Qaeda. While many hailed Compaoré as a man of peace, others claimed his image was simply a facade. France 24's Shirley Sitborn takes a closer look at the former strongman.
When Blaise Compaoré was invited to the French presidential palace 2 years ago, François Hollande received him as a guest of honor. As soon as he came to power in 1987, the Burkina-Bay president reinforced ties with France and the U.S., becoming one of their key allies in Western Africa. Their relations strengthened all along his 27 years in power. And during his long time in office, he became one of the region's main mediators, negotiating peace treaties in Liberia, Guinea, Ivory Coast, Togo, and Mali, and always pleading for democracy. The European Union, France, and the U.S. hail Blaise Compaoré as a man of dialogue. The France-Burkina Faso Association sees him as a candidate for the Nobel Peace Prize. But many say that the president's role in the region's conflicts is ambiguous.
Compaoré must have had some flaws, but he's also a great diplomat. He negotiated a great deal of peace treaties. There wouldn't have been elections in Mali if it weren't for him.
Was there a translation for that?
When Blaise Compaoré is about to end his last term, the president still believes he's an irreplaceable ally for France and the U.S. When Barack Obama says that African states should have strong institutions rather than strong men who eventually leave office, Compaoré disagrees.
There are no strong institutions if the men aren't strong too.
Less than 3 months later, protesters pushed Burkina Faso's president to resign. Apparently, they didn't want this strong man to stay in office for another 5 years.
Oh, we're still talking Burkina Faso right here on France 24. Dragos Redrao is a member of Burkina Faso's opposition. He joins us on the line from Bordeaux. Dragos, good evening to you. As a member of Burkina Faso's opposition, how important has today been for you?
Okay, I'm here. And the president has gone. But for the social movement, it's not the end of the movement, because you have to continue the struggle to get more freedom, more rights, human rights, and more social progress. And now the situation is still complicated, because the military had decided to take the power, but people don't need that. People want to have a veritable change in the condition of life, with democracy, with freedom, and so on. And but we are not sure that the new power taken by the military, the general, is for the real solution for people.
Dragos, just very quickly then, is the opposition concerned that the military is now running the country?
I think they say that they take the power for 3 months in the way to have a government of transition and to organize elections, new elections. They say that. But in the past, there were many coup d'etat in Burkina Faso. And at the We always say we take the power to organize the things, to organize a new election, but at the end, they stay in the power and there is no chance for people.
OK, Dragos Widrago, thanks very much for speaking to us on France 24. That's, I'm afraid, all we have time for. Well, in other news on the continent, a triple bombing in northern Nigeria has killed at least 8 people and wounded 41 others. The explosions were detonated during rush hour at a major bus station in Gombe City, capital of Gombe State. Police say they've arrested 3 suspects in connection with the attack. It's unclear whether extremists were behind today's explosions, but militants admitted bombing buses near Abuja in April and May, killing almost 100 people. And finally, here in the French capital this Friday, a memorial to commemorate victims of Rwanda's 1994 genocide has been inaugurated. The ceremony held at Pierre Lachaise Cemetery was attended by the mayor of Paris and members of a genocide survivors organisation. It's the first monument erected in Paris in memory of the genocide that saw nearly 800,000 people killed.
Survivors of the 1994 Rwandan genocide now have a place in Paris where they can mourn the victims. The new stele was inaugurated in the city's famous Père Lachaise Cemetery.
Each one of us survivors is a living monument. It is not an easy thing to carry on a daily basis. Having a place like this where we can come from time to time helps us to continue living.
We succeeded through sheer relentlessness and obstinacy. I'm very happy for the Rwandans, for the survivors living here in Paris who now have a memorial.
France already counts 5 steles in memory of the Rwandan genocide, but this is the first one in the capital.
Beyond its strong symbolism for humanity, this stele represents a burial place for those who could not bury and honor their dead after the genocide of the Tutsis in Rwanda. It makes Paris a city of refuge for the living.
Rwanda has regularly accused France of having backed the genocide perpetrators. But the focus at this cemetery was on the need to keep the memory of the genocide alive.
The duty of truth brings us together today.
Ensemble,
together, French and Rwandans must continue to fight ceaselessly against all forms of revisionism and denial and drive out these falsifiers of history.
Associations and victims are now waiting for the next step, a full monument in memory of the victims of the Rwandan genocide.
Okay, coming up next, more international headlines with Chris Moore. Do stay tuned.